kids, a lot of young kids. And we're invited. I see one other white person on the other side. We were invited by Radford. And so I don't know what's going to happen, but everyone's talking. These are, they have tribe and they have homeland. We don't have tribe, we don't have homeland. And when you take tribe and homeland away from humanity, you get what we got, which ain't particularly that enjoyable. This is their tribe, this is their home. And that's, you know, where is my homeland? Is it Russia, where my parents were from? Is it Florida, where they're buried? Is it the place I've lived the last 12 years? I don't know. You know where your homeland is? Where's your tribe? You know, this is our tribe. You know, because we got to see the whole world as our tribe and everywhere is our home. We got to be the generation and the people that see it's all one tribe and it's all one homeland. Wherever you are, your homeland. Whoever you're with, that's a tribal member. Even a guy you get stopped and get gas from on the way out later this week. That's your tribal member. So it's get to that point. So there's all these people, and there's a sense of excitement in the air. You can look out anywhere, and it's beautiful. And this was the women's basket dance. It teaches generosity. And so all of a sudden, off to my right, I hear drums going. And then the whole crowd gets a sense of anticipation and quiets down and everything. And the crowd opens up along the pathway on my right, and out of the underground round kiva, that is the Women's Basket Society for that village, starts to emerge from the ground about 30 or 40 women from 5 to 90 years old in elaborate Hopi, you know, dresses and head things that they've been spending all year making for this one ceremony. And they've been underground for the last 24 hours in ceremony, which is a hoot. Dawn, who you'll meet, who tells us about this, says, you know, you go down there with your aunts and your cousins and your nieces, and you pass on how to do the dance, and you feast, and the men bring the hand the food down to you, and you make the headdress that you've been working on all year anyway, and this is your ceremony, and you have a blast. They say it's laughing, playing, and kidding each other. So all these women start to come out of the ground, and everyone's quiet. There's a group of men with drums, and they're shuffling very quietly in their beautiful, gentle, feminine way into the center of the village. And they've got these baskets that would sell at a gift shop for $1,000. They worked all year to make this basket, and they're shaking the basket like this to bring the snow and the rain to water the crops in this semi-arid area, right, as they move. And as you look at these women, you realize these aren't American women. These are Hopi women. If I were to marry, you know, Renee, which we wouldn't do bad together, Renee. You married my cousin, we're only one step away. If I'm Eagle Clan and she's Fox Clan, guess what? Children are Fox Clan. I moved to the Fox Clan compound. The Fox Clan owns the fields, the tools, the house. I cannot even discipline my own daughters because they're Fox Clan women. And only their uncles and grandfathers can discipline them. No incest. No fear of women for the men. Can you imagine if men in our culture could not discipline their daughters? The daughters would not be afraid of their fathers. You see it? There would be no incest. If you touched that daughter, she'd go to her uncle and said, "My father, that Eagle Clan man, laid a hand on me. Well, I'm afraid of him." You see it? Knowing that the man had more testosterone, knowing that the man had more physical power, they built in a protective system to the women so that no one disciplines you except your own clan member. Wow. And you're not living with that person.
So do you have to marry someone from a different clan? Is that
yes.
Wow.
You can't marry within your own clan.
Wow.
You have to marry. And that keeps the interfertilization of the clan smooth relationships because you touch and base with all the clans. And if I divorce Renee, guess what? I leave with nothing. No house, no garden, no tools, no children. You know?
So.
Yeah, David, that puts you out of business. No lawyers. So out emerge these women. They're powerful women. You couldn't find, because I'm in, I'm not even gonna ask for a show of hands, but if I ask for a show of hands of how many women have been, had either physical or sexual trips laid on them, a lot of hands, if not everyone would go up here in this culture. And that demeans the female spirit, demeans you, and takes your power away. And even if it wasn't laid on you, when you go out there, someone's gonna make some sexual-oriented remark about either demeaning or, you know, towards you this week. And that don't happen out in Hopi Land. They have one person, every clan has a year, it has one person designated each year to have no negative thoughts. And so, and they're announced every year. Okay, you know, Maggie is this year, whatever the name is, and Maggie's gonna work on having no negative thoughts. So when you see Maggie at the gas station, at the high school football game, at the clinic, or out in the road, Maggie, how's it going? Trying, doing the best. I had a negative thought about my mother-in-law yesterday, but I let it go. Good, you gotta keep your mind clear for all of us.
Wow.
Isn't that beautiful? Yes, and every clan has somebody, I forget they have a name for it, wow, that does that. Huh. Because the Hopis believe it's not, just like Kubler Ross said, it's not just your deeds that are affecting the world around you, but yes, your thoughts. And Hopis are trained from birth, keep your thoughts pure. No revenge, no anger, no jealousy. You know what I mean? None of that thinking, no judgment, because your thoughts are affecting the world around you. So that's what they're trained to believe in, that when you pray, you are praying for all of humanity. You're gonna meet the Hopi elder and take this journey with us. So they come in, and they're coming in, and they make a circle around, and people behind them, people up on the roofs, and they've, it's been like 40, they're in no rush. There's been, I mean, you know, what are you gonna do in Hopi Land? We ain't rushing through this ceremony. When I was a synagogue, man, I couldn't wait to the end of that ceremony. Because then you got the little eclairs in the dining hall. And I didn't know what they were saying because it was in Hebrew, right, David?
That's right.
What do I care what the rabbi and the cantor, it's all in Hebrew. And then you got that 10-minute sermon from the rabbi, and that was BS. That was in English. And then came that last song, that one, I forget the name of the song, but it closed every service. Eclairs! Did my duty, came to synagogue Friday night. Eclairs. Anyway, they're doing, they got no, they ain't going nowhere. They got no problem if those women sit and shake those baskets while those drums are going and they shuffle around for an hour, hour and a half, to where everyone's in like a meditation. Can you imagine you're sitting on and looking out over a barren landscape for hundreds of miles in a village where people lived in 1,000 years? Wow. And you're just going to be in this meditation with all these people shaking these baskets down, those drums going, and the women making those soft little gentle motions to where the whole tribe is like in this Zen state. And even my Ashkenazi Jewish brain slowed down.
No eclairs.
And you walk by the houses and there's big feasts set up with mutton stew and pinky bread and corn to celebrate afterwards, just like Yom Kippur, Rosh Hashanah, to break the fast for Yom Kippur. So they come in and they get this meditative state, and then it stops, and there's this sense of excitement. And these men bring in big black garbage bags. Wouldn't expect that, would you? Full of something. And they put 5 of them in the middle. What's that about? And then the 5 women that had, the older women that had these really amazing extraterrestrial looking headdresses that came out, weren't feathers and everything, it was like, came out in all areas, peel off and they walk up to the bags, and now the crowd's pumped. Yes, time. And they go in there, and in these bags are spatulas and a mix of cornbread and toilet paper and little measuring cups. They start throwing it to the crowd. It's November, the winter's coming, time to share, time to get ready for the winter. In the old days, it was a leg of venison, a prairie dog, some corn, an apple, but now it's all this. And they start to throw it out. And what you notice, except for the young teenage boys who kind of good natured fight, no one fights for it. Cooperation, generosity. If I catch it and put it down there, no one's going to steal it. No one's going to grab it out of my hand. But then they take these baskets worth $1,000 to throw that out. Can you imagine if you throw it out to a crowd of Americans, something worth $1,000? It'd be a bloodbath. How about that home run ball for the World Series? You know? They throw it out. Whoever gets the $1,000 basket gets the basket. But then they see a man in a wheelchair. They go and give him a piece of pottery that's worth $1,000. They've worked on all year. And then they see a man just lost his wife. They go give him a basket.
Wow.
And they see somebody who's got a terminally ill sickness, and they go give them a special thing. Generosity. Give to those that are sick, those that are suffering, those that are in pain, those that have lost somebody. You see it? This goes on for like an hour and a half, and people are having a great time. They throw it up on the roof, and of course, you fight on the roof, you can fall in there, so no one fights. You know what I mean? And they except for little high school age boys who good nature fight, it's this beautiful, fun thing that goes on for, you know, and if people make great saves in the air and jump up and catch it. If you catch it, it's yours. And everyone's got a stash over here. And when they go and they give that basket to the person in the wheelchair, there's this, everyone just together. And everyone knows that you're in the wheelchair. Or if they walk up and they gave you because you just lost your mate, a beautiful pottery, everyone's heart goes out to that person. Like everyone says, yes, take that piece of pottery because we want to comfort you in your pain, your loss, your fear, whatever it is. Beautifully simple, beautifully done, right? And this goes on for like an hour and a half. Now you're like 3 hours into this thing. You know, no eclairs. I'm not even thinking eclairs. And then when that's done, they put it away and they take a little rubber 59-cent ball about that big, and everyone gathers and fills in the space. They throw the ball up in the air, and the game is to keep the ball up in the air. Cooperation. There's no stars. There's no player better than the other. 12-year-old kid or 30-year-old man or 90-year-old woman plays equally. And the game is to keep the ball in the air as long as you can. And if someone blows it and drops, and if someone makes a great save, yeah. But everybody has a great time. And that's, now you're like 5 hours into this absolutely fun thing that for 1,000 years have been keeping generosity and cooperation vivid in their mind. Right? And now it's time to feast. I mean, isn't that a brilliant way to keep human wisdom alive?
Yeah.
Robert, your screen is saying you got to push something in 4 minutes.
Oh, stand by. Thank you, Maggie. We have to use our personalities and bodies. Press enter. So, Julia and I read all this information and we say, oh my God, look what's been going on. Press enter. See, technology and I just don't quite do it. I'm pressing enter. Enter standby mode. Oh, I see. Enter standby. Doesn't say press enter. See, I just saw enter. There we go. Oh, good. That cuts it off. Oh, me. You might not have to use these projectors and get the lamp back on.
I don't have to deal with this at all.
Well, then you wouldn't be able to meet Radford and Dawn. When in doubt, unplug it and then plug it back in, start over.
That sounds like Marco.
Yeah.
When you close
or reboot the computer.
When you close yours down, do you go to start and then go up to a little thing that says either standby, log off, or whatever?
On the computer screen. But I can't get the computer screen up there until, it's coming
down.
Up.
Your computer shut down.
I think it's booting up. So, it's blinking for the lamp. So Julia and I read these books and we said, my gosh, look what's been going on out there. This is really powerful. We've done 54 concerts in Jamaica to big up the Jamaican people. Let's go out and thank the Hopis for what they've done. So I called the schools, and so I called a couple of reggae artists, Abby Jot, Joseph Israel, and Zima. And I said, look, guys, if we can, there it is. If we can put this together, will you come out and play for free? And they said, absolutely. So I call all the different schools, the high school, the grammar schools, the three grammar schools, and the high school, and I said, and remember, the Hopis don't want cultural influences. If I was gospel, they said, you ain't coming. If I was, you know, talking about Rasta, if I'm talking about Judaism, you ain't coming. If I call and say I want to bring reggae artists to the school to talk to the kids and perform for the kids, come on out. The principal say, come on out, because you're reggae, One Love Conscious Reggae. So all the principals said, yeah, come on out. Wow. We'll put you in front of the kids. So Julia and I go out there, we meet the different performers out there and stay in the little cultural center mode hotel. There's one hotel with 20 rooms, that's all that's on the reservation, one restaurant. And we start to go and we start to do these concerts at the different schools over a 3-day period, one public concert at the Veterans Hall where all the other reggae concerts have happened. And our message is simply to say, your people are the covenant people. You've held a vision of becoming Hopi for the entire race, and we've come out here to thank you for doing that. And that you are now at peace with your tribes, between clans, between villages, with the Navajo and Tewa neighbors, with the white man, with the white government, with the tribal government. You have almost completed this covenant. And if you go to Hopi land, let me tell you what you see. We'll ride around there and the Hopi elder will say, you see those ruins over there? Well, way back, long before white men came, that village got so sexually promiscuous, way before the white men, I'm talking about after cable came in here. I'm talking about, like, you know, 1,000 years ago, or not 1,000, maybe 600 years ago, that they were having sex orgies in the kivas. So that village got destroyed. That taught us what? Don't go into promiscuity. You see that village, ruins? Those people, the men bet their women against the foot race with another village and lost. So all the women went over to the other village. That taught us don't gamble, right? Which came up relevant. You see this village over here? That village Christianized themselves and got tired of our ways, and that village was destroyed. And you see this village over here? The chiefs started wearing big ceremonial outfits, didn't want to work anymore, made everybody work for them, misuse of power. That village was destroyed. So there in the landscape are all human foibles, all the dead end paths, sex, power, money. That's the three big ones, sex, power, money. You know, that's the big foibles. And, you know, so they are almost completing this thing. So we go out there and we thank them for doing this. And now let me show you the video footage of that. Would you like to see it?
Yes.
It'll be an extra $9.95 from each one of you.
I'll pay.
Is that correct, Jay?
Money.
Yeah. Yeah. Computer's going through a lot of changes. Okay, good. This is Abby Ja, you're about to meet. So this is, the most amazing one was at the Hopi High School. Imagine this, 850 kids and their teachers at a big modern high school auditorium, big plush seats. And on stage is this powerful Jamaican band with Abby Ja. And there was this one, and they're stoic. They're not like the Jamaican kids, they're stoic Native Americans. And there's this one moment when Abby Ja hit the first Bob Marley song, Three Little Birds. And Julia, in her beautiful, graceful way, danced down the center aisle. And spontaneously, half the crowd leapt to their feet and followed her to the front of the stage. And for the next hour and a half, sang the words, all the words in unison to every Bob Marley song, a man from Jamaica who'd been dead before any of them were born. And they knew the words to every one of his songs. And the beautiful, open-hearted principal, Glenn, came up to me and he said, Robert, my maintenance man said we got to stop the concert because the kids are standing on chairs, they're pulling them out of the concrete floor bolts. And he said, I don't care, nothing stopping this concert. I ain't never seen Hopi kids act like this. You'll see that coming up.
I wish you had that on video.
Huh?
I wish you had that on video. That would be
fun. We do.
Oh, you do?
Yeah.
Oh.
I'm going to put a lot of this on YouTube this week or next month, whenever I get one of my young friends to help me.
What if you look it up under just Gathering of the
Under my name, it'll be up there. Now that's Oribe. This is the oldest inhabited place on the North American continent. That's a village out there. You see it? No electricity in this village. So it's 950 years old. Not allowed to take photographs in the village. There's only a handful of people left living there. That's Juliet Prophecy Rock. Radford, you're going to meet him soon. This is their saying. Listen what they're saying. Together with all nations, we protect both land and life and hold the world in balance. That's their covenant. They're holding the world in balance, love and life, land and life for the entire planet. And this is their prophecy rock. And their prophecy rock shows two lines with people on both lines. One line has a lot of people to it. And as it goes straight, and then it starts to get jig-jaggy, and it goes around the corner, and it fades out. That's materialism. It's not going to last forever, and it's a tough path. The other path has a few people on it, and it's straight, and it keeps going around the rock, and keeps going forever. That's the Creator's way. And there's a line that connects the two. You can always change. You can always move from one path to the other. Another one of their prophecy rocks. Let's see. I'm going to skip here a little bit and we'll come back to this in a second. Let me just make sure this is, yeah. You're about to meet Radford. The way we met Radford, let me just see if I can, no, I'll just do. Radford is the traditional, he's the eyes, ears, and tongue of the Hopi 11 spiritual leaders of the Mother Village. So this is the highest level of their spiritual hierarchy, and he is their eyes, ears, and tongue. At the one of the small schools, a second grade teacher, you're going to see this coming out, came up to us and said, my father is the spirit, is a traditional snake priest, Radford. And Radford dances with a rattlesnake in his mouth and a rattlesnake in each hand. He's a traditional snake priest, and I'm so glad that you came out with these reggae artists and helped us. You'll hear her make her little speech. She connected us to her father, who said, this white couple's coming out here bigging up a tribe. He requested to meet us on behalf of the spiritual elders, and then we started to work with Radford to put the book together. A year and a half later, we were asked by the Leonard Pelcher Group, who Leonard's the Native American activist, has been in jail 30 years, could we do a fundraiser and bring together some reggae artists? We said, absolutely. We'll bring Travis Terry, who's flute music. You've been hearing. You're going to meet Travis. We'll bring one of the bands, Native Roots, out there for free. And I'll call Radford and see if Radford will join us. Call Radford, and Radford said, yes, I'd love to come speak at that. And Danny Diaz joined us. So me and Julia and Radford, his family, went to Prescott, Arizona, and did this event. That was a painting that you just saw that Leonard Pelcher did. Oh, actually, this is in order, so that's okay. This is the Sister Parrot. She's the Hopi reggae disc jockey. We went to, there's Abby Jai, and we went there, and she's speaking in the Hopi dialect and out into the night, and everyone in the reservation is listening to her reggae show, and she's speaking, you know, and then Bushman, Damon Marley, you know, it's all Hopi, but then you recognize these reggae artists' names. Here's Julia and Abby Jai at one of the schools. There's our Fire Forgiveness. Here's this song. Listen to the words of this. This will be a revelation.
Take you down, open to wash you down, but he went to the restaurant.
two verses. Abby Ja, Revelation. He did all 54 concerts with us in Jamaica. That's Abby Ja. You're going to see him live. Here we are at another one of the schools. The Covenant, I talked to Red for 2 months ago and he said the Covenant's in trouble. The new kids all got computers and the young generation is forgetting the covenant. And they're not doing the ceremonies, they're getting bored, they're moving at mock speed on the internet.
Yeah.
And I said, you know, Ranford, they're not listening to you, they're not listening to me and Julie, but I know who they're listening to. They're listening to reggae artists.
Yeah.
The reggae artists come out there, right, and say, don't let this covenant die. They command huge respect. They're the only people that these high school kids respect. So I come, and Buddy Whaler, whose roots, Bob Marley and the Wailers, and Bros Michael, whose roots, Elder Marley, and the Marley Boys will be right over in that field in 10 days. So I called Bunny Whaler in Jamaica because he's performed with us. And I called Ross Michael because he knows our work. And I said, guys, will you go and talk? You don't have to perform. I don't want to take money out of the tribe. I don't want you to go there and perform and take money home. I want us to go out there at our cost. We're not even going to pay your way. You got to be able to go in front of that crowd and say, I've come all this way at my own expense to bring one message to you. Do not let your clans, your tribes, covenant be broken. You're close to finishing it. Don't do it. Put those computers aside and listen to your elders and get back in the ceremony. And both Bunny and Ross Michael said, sounds good. I said, I can't imagine what we'd have more important things to do that day. I said, you're one of a handful of people on this planet that can save this covenant. So we're going to reason about that at Rollick's, and I'm going to approach the Marley Boys who are in our books and know of our work. We've worked with their sister and their mother and their grandmother. So that's what we're going to try to put together to bring them out there and say, like Julia said, we don't care who comes. Who's ever supposed to come will come. We'll offer the invitation. If they feel guided to do it, they'll do it. And if not, I'll take a video of them saying it and bring it out there. It won't be quite as much, but I'll take a video. So I bought that video camera a few days ago to take the video.
When do y'all plan to go?
Whenever all of them can come together. You know, so I'll talk to them about that. And so we're going to call Radford when we get home and tell them I'm going to call Radford next week. I'm Mr. Radford, I want to make sure we're clear. When I meet with these artists here, can I say that I'm offering the invitation on behalf of the 11 Hopi elders? Can I make that statement that I represent an emissary from your elders to invite them to come? Because if your elders aren't inviting them to come, I don't want to make the invitation. You know what I mean? Bunny and Ross Michael were right there with me.
But what did he say?
Huh?
Did he say yes?
They said, let's discuss when we're in North Carolina. You know? First, they were quick to say no money. They wouldn't charge any money. I said, no, it's not that. We're not even going to pay your way. Julie and I can't afford it. We don't pay our way. So you got to pay your own way to do this. And I said, but they understand, they know what Rastafari reggae music has done for this tribe already. And every reggae artist will tell you the greatest audience you can get is the Hopi audience. This is the high school. We're going to go there in a second. Abby Jotha High School. It's on our way out there to do the performances.